Hallo everyone, we are today here at the Militärhistorisches Museum der Bundeswehr in Dresden, and this is Jens Wehner.
Hello.
And we will talk about why all those Beutewaffen, all those loot weapons for the Wehrmacht in the Second World War, and why they were so important. And here we're in front of an Infanterieschlepper UE-603 in Klammer F, 28-32 cm Wurfgerät 41. So basically an infantry tow vehicle, and this was a French vehicle, thus parent is F, and with rockets 20 centimeter or 32 centimeters up there. So this was a repurposed vehicle, basically this was a tankette, I would say, and it was later equipped to be like a tracked Nebelwerfer. But there were many other weapons the German repurposed. So what was the, because I have seen the messages and sometimes in comments like, the Germans were so ingenuine, they repurposed everything, and the other viewers, of course, they had to do this because other countries, I mean, to a certain degree, also used loot weapons, but I think to a far lesser degree than the Wehrmacht. So what is the background behind this?
So yeah, it's a mixture of several reasons why the Wehrmacht had so much Beutewaffen. I think one reason is that the Wehrmacht fought a big war and they were a big army and they needed a lot of weapons. And of course, they needed more weapons than they could produce. And the reason behind this is that the German industry, especially the automotive industry, was not that strong. And the reason behind this is that the income in Germany before the war, before World War II, was quite low. It was much lower than in France, Great Britain, or the USA. So German wealth, German life standard was not that good as in the other bigger Western countries, nations, and the people couldn't afford cars.
So they went to motorcycles, because I think the motorcycle industry was extremely well developed.
Yeah, and that's the reason why the Wehrmacht had so many Gradschützen. Because the Germans were a people of motorcycles and not so much of cars. And of course, this had some backward effects on the armament industry. They couldn't produce that much cars, and they were weak on this sector. And when they invaded in France and they conquered France and they conquered all the vehicles out of France, they took what they could get out of this. Especially where I think a part of the Wehrmacht which is really wild when it comes to Beutewaffen is lorries.
There are dozens
of lorries and trucks and so on.
Especially in the Panzer divisions, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. But wherever you look, it's really crazy what they have.
And they are also, I mean, probably most famous is the Panzer 38T and the Panzer 35T. Those are the Czech tanks that were captured, although the Panzer 38T was actually produced after they were taken over. This is sometimes because some people are in the invasion of Poland, they were important. And as I pointed out in one video, not yet. They were way more important in the invasion of the Soviet Union, actually. Rommel was very fond of the Panzer 38T in the invasion of France. And I think only during Operation Barbarossa, they reached around 20% or something. But I will put the numbers below because there's sometimes this misconception going on, and I was quite surprised myself. So what else is to say about all those Beutewaffen?
Yeah, the Beutewaffen had of course major problems, especially when it comes to logistic.
Yeah.
If you talk of dozens of types of lorries and trucks and tracks and pulling machines and tractors and whatever, you have to have spare parts, you have to have maintenance, you have to have repair capacities, and you have to have people that can handle all this equipment, which is quite complicated. And I think this was in some ways a logistical nightmare. And if you look at Operation Barbarossa, the Wehrmacht had a high quota of lorries or trucks, and they lost a lot in the first year of the war, and they couldn't really replace it. I mean, they could replace the tanks. Yeah, everybody knows the tanks. I think everybody knows they had Panzer III with with a special cannon with L-42, and then they had the L-60, and then they came the Panther, and so on, and everybody knows this. But when it comes to trucks, the Wehrmacht was not so well equipped, and they had really problem in the later stage of the war to motorize their own army.
There was also, I think, the demotorization started, I think, already in 42 or something.
That's I would even say it started a little bit in 41 due to the high losses. But I think it was not so feelable for the Wehrmacht. It was not, it had not that impact yet in 41. But, and so it started, you can
and
say,
in 41, they also used a lot of captured Soviet equipment as well. A lot of the light tanks they captured, for instance, they also used, like, similar to this. And then when they couldn't repair it anymore, they just left them.
Yeah, but there were some problems. When I made a lecture on the Panzer Museum about the Soviet tank disaster in 41, I think one user wrote under the video, what's about the Beutewaffen with all these tanks that were lost by the Soviet army, by the Red Army. And I think you don't see that much T-26 in the Wehrmacht. And the reason is because these tanks were old and they were really hard to maintain and to repair, so they didn't use it. You see a lot of French tanks, you see some of the more modern Soviet tanks like KV-1, KV-2, T-34 or so and so on. And but you don't see that much the older Soviet tanks because they were also a maintenance nightmare and a repair nightmare, I think.
Yeah, it could also be. I mean, to a certain degree, it could also be that the troops at the front directly reused them, because I remember a few years ago, I asked a question on Reddit because I have this, there's the statistics from the Wehrmacht, how many tanks they captured in Operation Barbarossa, and it was like a huge number, like 10 or 20,000. And I was like, where went they all? Because I know they had like T-34s that they used to put on their own commander's cupola. But for all the others, I didn't. And then people started putting out pictures, and I think they used like the BT tanks. They removed the turret and they used them to tow vehicles or guns around or something. And maybe the same happened with the T-26, I don't know.
Yeah,
but I mean, it's a good point because the T-26...
I think that happened also with the T-26, but not in a way and in a quantity that you would predict.
Yeah,
because of the numbers they made of captive weapons.
For the Atlantic War, for instance, the Beutewaffen were also of major importance because the Bodenständige divisions, basically immobile divisions, they were just there for defense. They were often equipped with equipment like captured equipment. I mean, even the Panzerlehr division, the Panzerlehr division at one point was equipped with heavy artillery from the Soviet side.
Yeah, but the reason behind this is that when it comes to artillery,
the Soviet were better in that.
Yeah, the heavy mortar from the Soviet Union, the 120 millimeter mortar, and I think the 122 millimeter howitzer also.
Yeah,
those were artillery pieces that were a little bit more capable than the Wehrmacht ones, and they even produced own shells for this and so on. So they really decided to use this.
I mean, this is, as Adrian Wettstein pointed out in Wehrmacht in Stadtkampf, that the problem was with counter-artillery fire, that the Soviet artillery usually had a longer range than the Germans, and so that kind of makes sense. So sometimes the Beutewaffen were because they were better, but this was usually the exception, and in other times, third-rate or second-rate units were equipped with Beutewaffen, especially the Atlantic Wall. I mean, they put everything in there. They put, like, turrets from old tanks in there in fortified positions, and one historian actually referred to the Atlantic Wall as an artillery museum, a European artillery museum, because they put everything there. But the main problem was, if you have a limited amount of shells, then you fire at the enemy, and when your shells are gone, well, the weapon is completely useless at that point.
Yeah, and again, you have also a little bit problem then. I think with the different calibers and so on, you know, if you use an Italian gun, maybe it's not correctly the same, maybe some small differences and so on. So the logistics are, again, a little bit difficult.
Even the handling, because I have seen, like, for artillery, like I pointed out in my Sturmtiger video, they note at a certain degree the gun is too inaccurate. And I have seen some artillery tables. And these are sometimes for degrees, for wind, and they count for everything. And then you need actually the tables, how they work, so else you won't hit anything. And there's actually one interesting example again in Adrian Wettstein's Wehrmacht in Stadtkampf. He noted at one point that, and this was a German weapon, that they had, I think, special grenades, or they had grenades for something, but they didn't get these firing tables yet. So they couldn't use the ammunition. And now imagine you have a French gun, I don't know, from interwar year, and you have some ammunition, and do you have the firing tables? And then you have another gun, and another artillery gun, and then you have a Sobat one. You need firing tables for all these weapons to use them properly, else it's more or less fine the general direction. So this is something, because, well, artillery is completely understudied, I think. A handful of books.
I agree.
And I looked a bit in the original army regulations to get a basic idea, and I barely know anything. And they have every time they have a Schießvorschrift, a shooting or firing regulation, and I hadn't. And usually a lot of math and a lot of graphs, and I didn't have time to look at it. But I know that's quite complicated. So even there, it's from the combat capabilities, your units will be reduced, especially if you equip third-rate troops with it. So you equip third-rate troops with limited ammunition and with limited data, probably. So,
I mean, the data should be the least problem.
Really?
Like this.
I mean, in one case, they didn't had for their own guns the data, so...
Yeah, but it was new. It was new.
It could be new, but... That then again, you ship the ammunition without it. Maybe
something like
this. That's a good point.
I think this is not so common or not the main problem. But the main problem is stuff like soldiers' training. Yeah, how to use the gun, how to get a good
especially
fire rate.
Especially with limited ammunition.
How to get a good fire rate, the logistical nightmare. And the Wehrmacht already had some problems with logistics, so it was not that the Wehrmacht was free of logistical problems or could take it in that way. So I think one has to think about maybe the Beutewaffen were more a problem than useful, you know, in some ways, at least in some ways, because the diversity of the types were too much and too different usages and too many problems with that. So maybe they used it too much. And also, if you look at this Renault, which isn't original, because the Wolfram is original and also the Renault is original, but not the putting together.
Okay.
This is made after the war by someone, I don't know who. But I don't know, you have to have somebody in back of the front to put it together, to put together all those Waffen. I know historians sometimes say Bastelladen Wehrmacht, so, you know, do it yourself, do it yourself shop. Wehrmacht. And I once met a lieutenant who was one of the, let's say, inventors of the Flakpanzer. And he was a lieutenant in the Panzerwerkstatt Minsk. And the first Flakpanzer he constructed was a T-34 with MK-103 cannons from the Air Force. Vierling, so four guns. And this took a lot of time and some material and so on. And I don't know, maybe this was some logistical or repair capacity that was not available to repair tanks, to keep the Pandas and the Tigers and so on alive, to keep them ready, combat ready. So I think the Beutewaffen is a little bit a difficult topic, because on the one side, of course, it was material that was needed, that was used, okay. But on the other side, it made so many problems, it produced so many problems that in the end, I'm not sure if it was useful every time.
Well, I assume probably for the defense, like putting on the bodenständige divisions on the Atlantic Wall, it probably made the most sense, because you ship the ammo once and then you're done.
Yeah, but in the end, what does a bodenständige division mean? How many how much combat power such a division had.
Well, I mean, this is quite interesting. Mm. The Atlantic War, I had a discussion with Trajanifla about this, and the issue is that it's not about the combat power. I mean, for the defense, it makes sense, and you need something there. So the invasion of Europe created a lot of hedges for the Allies, and if the bodenständige divisions would not have been there, it would be way easier for them. So to a certain degree, it makes sense. But for the offensive, I think there's more of a problem that you have this a lot of body waffen. I think because there you have to expand your logistics or you drop the weapon at one point.
Mm. But I'm not sure how much capacity the bodenständige division really needed, you know? And we don't know how much training they get, how much personnel that was maybe well-educated, well-trained, were in the division still.
Because is there any study about them?
Probably no, I don't think. I don't think. I think it's also an understudied topic. In general, also the infantry divisions. It's not only the artillery. It's also the logistical stuff of Wehrmacht. I think you once made a YouTube about this.
Yeah, I made a video about, talked about the basics, But as far as I know, there's not really a book out on the, well, at least not an academic work on the whole logistical situation.
Yeah, so you see it, we are talking more or less about guessings, about artillery, about infantry, and about logistics. And this of one of the biggest armies that ever existed that fought a world war.
Yeah, and which is also in popular media, everyone is
and
on
and
it.
And for this, a museum is quite good because you have a thing like this and you have the questions, you know, maybe you don't see it that much on YouTube or on books, but you have the stuff that is left and this gives you some questions. Why they do this, why they did this, why and how, and was it useful or not, and so on. And what implications, I mean, also what implications had it on the soldiers when they used so much captive equipment?
That's actually a good question. I never saw this.
I mean, and sometimes maybe the equipment was even better. Who knows? Sometimes it was the case, I think. And, you know, not only stuff like engine power or cannon firepower or stuff like this, but also how does it feel to sit in the ergonomics and the convenience and all the stuff. Maybe you think, oh, I'm sitting in a French tankette and this is quite well designed, maybe a little bit better than other stuff you drove around from German production also.
Yeah.
So it would be really interesting to see what German soldiers would think about this.
Actually, yeah, I never saw anything about this. But yeah, then I don't read very much into diaries or memoirs. So actually, it's quite an interesting question. So now we have actually more questions after the video than before the video. So, well, thank you very much, Jens.
Yeah, thank you.
And also a big thank you to the Militärhistorisches Museum der Bundeswehr in Dresden. Thank you for watching and see you next time.